And we're now joined by Metro Manila Council President and San Juan City Mayor Francis Zamora. Good morning, Mayor. Thanks for joining us.
Yes, good morning, Kat, and thank you for having me on Head Start.
Okay. Yesterday, we reported that the MMDA plans to appeal to the Supreme Court to reconsider the temporary restraining order issued against the NCAP. But it cites data from the agency saying that the number of accidents tripled since the NCAP was suspended in August last year. But first, Mayor, would it be fair to actually attribute all these accidents, the figure at 32,739 traffic violations in May 2023 alone, is it fair to attribute this increase in incidents to the suspension of the NCAP alone?
That, right now, I'm holding data from the MMDA, which states that during the month of August 2022, there were a total of 20,260 traffic violations. And for September, it went up to 22,000. October, 25,000, November, 24,000, December, 23,000. Now, January of this year, total violations were at 29,000, February, 27,000, March, 31,000, April, 26,000, and May, 32,000. Now, with regard to your question, I am basing my answer on two things. Number one, as you can see, the number of violations have increased after the suspension of NCAP. Am I saying that all of these are because of the suspension? Not really, but again, data will show that the number of violations have increased. And if you ask me, given the 4 years that I have been mayor, we really cannot have traffic enforcers all over the city of San Juan, and more so all over the entire of Metro Manila. So having the no contact apprehension policy really helps in deterring traffic violators from committing these traffic violations. Now, if there are no cameras in the streets, the tendency really is for them to violate, because they feel that if there are no traffic enforcers on the ground, they can violate without being penalized. So one thing that I learned during a trip to another country a few months ago, we were in Iceland, actually. And for those who have been to Iceland, there's this huge ring road that goes around the country. And even if there were no cars in the road for about an hour, hour and a half, our driver was just driving at the right speed, because she told us that there are cameras all over. So this is something that the NCAP can instill. In fact, in San Juan, we were never really able to implement it because the TRO was issued already. But given the data from the MMDA, you will see that indeed there is an increase in the number of violations during the suspension.
Mm-hmm. Sir, let's talk about that parallelism with Iceland. There's some big difference between the number of security cameras, of CCTV cameras, between Iceland and the Philippines, which is why their no contact apprehension policy is seemingly more effective compared to other countries. How do you address that? Because as far as we are concerned, one of the Supreme Court's main issues in its oral arguments is the lack of CCTV cameras, or even if there are CCTV cameras, it's the inefficiency of the operations of monitoring these cameras around the metro. How do you address that?
Okay, first, if you say inefficiency, it's very subjective. It will really depend on how the LG, for instance, will implement NCAP. There are LGUs that have implemented already before the TRO. San Juan was not able to implement, and the MMDA was able to implement. Now, one of the provisions of the agreement with the service provider is for them to set up high-tech cameras, which I have seen, although we were not able to use. So we spread them out in the key streets of San Juan. I'm talking about San Juan, Kat, because this is what I'm privy to. We spread them out all throughout the key or major roads in San Juan to be able to ensure that where most of the cars pass, these areas are covered by the CCTV, and it's able to zoom in to the driver. It's even able to get the data from the plate number, even if your car is quite tinted. So the equipment is high tech and is able to monitor the violations. So with regard to your question, it really depends on how the LGU, or in this case, how MMDA will spread out these cameras. Are they located in key areas in the national roads in Metro Manila, in EDSA, for instance? And are they able to really monitor the vehicles that pass? Mm-hmm. So this is a very subjective question, Kat.
Okay, and Mayor, what are your peers in the Metro Manila Council actually saying, considering that not all cities in the capital region are as rich as Quezon City or San Juan or Makati or Pasig? What are they actually saying with regard to this effort?
Kat, we will not spend anything for NCAP in San Juan, and this is the same thing with the other cities, because this is a PPP. It's a public-private partnership. Thus, the service provider spends for everything and recoups it by getting a percentage of the fines that are collected. So again, for us, we look at this as a win-win situation, because it allows us to be able to monitor our roads using these cameras. There is a command center set up to monitor 24 hours a day the key roads in our city that has NCAP.
Glad you clarified the business model there, Mayor, because again, one of the issues raised during the Supreme Court's oral arguments against the NCAP is the hefty fines that will be imposed against violators. How do you adjust the policy to make it more palatable to the High Court?
Okay, now I will now talk about the single ticketing system, which was approved by the Metro Manila Council via the approval of the Metro Manila Traffic Code. Now that we have the single ticketing system, which has common violations within the 20 usual traffic guidelines that are violated, the amounts of the fines are now uniformed across Metro Manila. And if and when, again, let me emphasize, if and when the NCAP will be allowed, then the rates must adjust to the single ticketing system rates. Because if we don't do this, then it will not be parallel to what we have passed, which is the Metro Manila Traffic Code. So I guess this is something that has to be done. There needs to be some adjustments with regard to the rates of the violations.
By how much do you intend to adjust these rates?
Well, again, no discussion yet, because the case is still in the Supreme Court. So if ever the TRO will be lifted, it must not be far from the existing single ticketing system rates. Possibly, I'm saying possibly, the service provider can add a convenience fee into the program, but it must not be so far from the existing fines of the single ticketing system. So this is something that may be discussed if and when the TRO is lifted.
Mm-hmm. And alongside the single ticketing system, several Metro Manila cities are also set to soft launch a handheld ticketing devices next month. San Juan City, I understand, is one of the five LGUs that will be part of this soft launch. Tell us more about this, sir. What can motorists expect from this handheld devices?
Okay, Kat. What is the value of the single ticketing system? Well, first, the amount of the fines across the 20 common violations in Metro Manila will be the same. And this will help ease the confusion in terms of how much to pay in case you're indeed caught for a violation. And for me, the most convenient part of this is, one, you can pay online. You can pay through digital payment platforms. And now, with the handheld devices, you could actually pay on the spot, because it will allow for credit card payment or even online transactions or payments as well. So you will not have to anymore go to City Hall to pay for your fines. You can pay on the spot using these handheld devices. And let me remind everyone that your licenses cannot be confiscated anymore.
Okay, I understand, sir, that training for the enforcers who will use these handheld devices will actually begin by the latter part of June, around June 27, I think. What are the primary roadblocks so far when it comes to their training, when it comes to rolling out this program of handheld devices in Metro Manila?
They will have to be familiarized with the operation of the gadgets. And here in San Juan, we have been using our own prior to the MMDA's distribution of the handheld gadgets. We were using our own, which we integrated with the LTO. So we have been using our own devices, and our enforcers are now used to using this technology. So when the new handheld devices from the MMDA arrive, we will just have to retrain them again. But I don't see too much problems in connection with this. It's just a matter of familiarization and proper training. And this is something that the MMDA will help us with. In fact, I'm very thankful to them. All Metro Manila mayors are thankful to the MMDA because they spent for these handheld devices. So the cities did not spend a single peso.
And how much?
Implementation.
Would you be privy to as to how much the MMDA actually spent to procure these devices?
Kat, I don't have the exact figures now, but all of this went through the proper bidding process. And it's also why it took some time, because there is a procurement process that needs to be followed. And in fairness to Chairman Artes of the MMDA, this process was followed. And we are just waiting now for the actual distribution so that we can fully roll out in Metro Manila. I am very excited for this. I have received so much positive feedback from the public, especially during our pilot run. Before, during years back, when there was still no single ticketing system, what would happen was your driver's license would be confiscated. And if you live, for instance, in the Ilocos region or Bicol region, and you just happen to pass by Metro Manila and you get caught for a violation, you will have to actually still go back to the city where you were caught and pay your fines. Now this will not happen. Wherever you are in the Philippines, you can pay your violations through digital payment platforms. And now with these handheld devices, you can actually pay on the spot.
Mm-hmm. And will convenience fees or service charges be actually imposed against motorists who will opt to pay their fines through these handheld devices? Will there be like an additional charge here, sir?
Yes, there will be convenience fees depending on the digital payment platform that the cities will partner with. Again, remember, this is just an option, Kat. If the motorist would still want to physically go to City Hall to pay for his or her fines, then that is an option. But if you have to pay, for instance, an additional 25 pesos or an additional 50 pesos, but save yourself time, gasoline, and having to go through the traffic, then it is your option to pay digitally. And again, the new option of paying on the spot using the credit card is now available. So we are giving people options. We are not forcing them to pay through online platforms. They still have the option to go physically if they wish.
Mayor, how do you insulate this new system, this new scheme from corrupt practices? Because it's common wisdom that when there is human intervention, it becomes more prone to corruption. How do you actually protect this scheme from that, considering that bribes or what we call lagay can actually be paid during these e-platforms as well? They can simply Gcash their bribes to several police officers or traffic enforcers.
Yeah, when you are apprehended for a traffic violation and you decide to pay on the spot or through digital payment platforms, the payment does not go to the traffic enforcer. So it goes straight to the account of the LGU. For instance, here in San Juan, we have our digital payment platforms via StarPay. So if you get caught here and you wish to pay on the spot, you can use our QR code. And in this QR code, the payment details will be indicated. So it goes straight to our bank accounts, and in no way will it go to the traffic enforcers.
We understand the technology, Mayor, but then again, you will have human intervention there. Corrupt traffic enforcers can simply haggle with drivers, telling them that you can simply Gcash a cheaper amount to his or her personal account instead of paying on the spot, which will be a more palatable, more attractive option for motorists. How do you protect the system from those kinds of haggling, considering that since the NCAP is still not in place, there will still be contact when it comes to apprehension?
There will be less contact because, this is a digital platform. And next, we are planning in the next phase the procurement of body cameras for the traffic enforcers. So this will now safeguard both aspects of the apprehension, the violator, and those apprehending. This is something that we are now planning for. And of course, at any point that you are apprehended by an erring traffic enforcer, please report to us. We will make sure that they go through the necessary process. They will be disciplined, and if needed, we can file cases against them. So in case you encounter any such instance, please inform us, and we will take proper action. That's something I guarantee.
Mm-hmm. Mayor, when do you intend to roll out these body cameras, and what is the ideal target ratio of body cameras to enforcers to make sure that a lot, if not all areas in the Metro Manila would be covered by this surveillance scheme?
Okay, this is the next phase of our planning. In fact, we are now discussing how to proceed. First things first, we have to be able to distribute the handheld devices to the LGUs. Now, as to the number, of course, it will depend really on the key areas where traffic is heavy in the different cities in Metro Manila. So that will be determined by the mayors and, of course, by the MMDA. So this is something that is now being planned for and discussed, and this will be the next phase in our implementation of traffic rules and regulations here in Metro Manila.
Okay, Mayor, let's move to another issue being discussed by the Metro Manila Council. Last month, you mentioned that the council is discussing a proposal for a temporary ban on activities that use big volumes of water. Any update on that, sir?
Okay, just to clarify, it is not a ban. Basically, it is the regulation of the usage of water. In fact, yesterday during the meeting, the regional director of the Office of Civil Defense was reporting regarding the recommendations of the different LGUs. And something that we had agreed upon was for the Metro Manila Disaster Risk Reduction Management Council to come out with a framework which the LGUs will follow. And one thing that I was pushing for yesterday, which I can articulate this morning, is that we can set up rain catchment areas in our cities. Just to make it less complicated, basically, these will be funnels that will catch water into drums. And for instance, it rains hard within today, we will be able to collect the rainwater and reuse and recycle this collected water in any way that can help us in our daily activities, such as cleaning toilets, watering the plants. And in fact, if the water is cleaner than usual, you can actually use it in other activities. And this is something that can help us in terms of water conservation. And also, all cities must have legislation against water pilferage. That is something that also affects the supply of water in Metro Manila and, of course, in other areas in the country. So it will now depend on the LGUs on how to pass resolutions and ordinances, because not all LGUs have the same demographics. For instance, here in San Juan, we do not have any golf course. We do not have any big hotels. We do not have resorts. So our demographics is different from other cities that may have these establishments. So it will now depend on the LGUs, again, depending on their needs in their cities.
Sir, speaking of demographics, does the Metro Manila Council have data on which Metro Manila cities actually consume the largest volume of water in the capital region?
That I don't have that information right now, but it would be the water concessionaires that would know. Of course, there are two concessionaires in Metro Manila. That's Manila Water and Manila, so they would be in the best position to know. And that's something that I can find out.
Initially, last month, if I recall correctly, based on news items, some of the proposals were to actually regulate the operations of car wash businesses as well as the use of inflatable pools. Is this still on the table, sir?
Again, it will depend on the LGU's cut. If they would like to pass legislation for this, that is an option. But again, since we have different demographics, it will have to be customized per local government unit.
All right. We will have to leave it at that. And we look forward to hearing more from you regarding these measures that have yet to be finalized. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, San Juan Mayor Francis Zamora.
Thank you very much, Kat.